A very warm welcome on behalf of myself. I'm Anshu Bharadwaj from CSTEP, and our partners from SDC, Mary Lore, and from Shakti Foundation, Chinmaya. I request Mary Lore from SDC, Chinmaya from Shakti, Seema ji from CII, and Dr. Bhatt Saab from MOEFCC, if you could kindly come on the dais, please. Our distinguished guests, none of them need any introduction. They are all very familiar to all of us in this space of energy, environment, climate issues. Dr. J.R. Bhatt is a senior advisor in Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And for decades, he has been somebody who has been associated closely with India's climate policy initiatives. And he has represented India in COPs and played a key role in shaping India's policy options in this climate policy space. So welcome, Dr. Bhatt Saab. Thank you for, I understand you had a very busy schedule today, but still you and Ajay could spare time and come. Sincerely grateful for that. Mrs. Seema Arora is DDG of Confederation of Indian Industries, CII, a very well-known figure in the area of industry and also looking at adoption of renewables, decarbonization, how to ensure there is uptake of these options by the industry, because that's where rubber meets the road. She has been very actively played a role in ensuring policy engagement of industry on these issues, organizing workshops, and for building support. So I welcome Seema. Thank you for sparing your time and coming over. Mary Love from SDC. I thank SDC for supporting this initiative. Grateful for their support in the first year and the fact that they fully were involved both in funding this initiative as well as in intellectual support. And I thank you for your close involvement and keen engagement to the team in providing inputs. And Chinmaya, who is the interim CEO of Shakti Foundation, he and I have sort of co-led this program, and Chinmaya, as partner in this journey, welcome and thank you. So friends, I'll just take maybe 5 minutes of your time to, for the benefit of all of you who are not familiar with this initiative, to explain what this is about, why we thought of this platform, what have we done in the last 1 year, and then I'll request Mary Lore to speak about her perspective, and then Chinmaya about the road ahead for IETP. So as you know, we IETP stands for India Energy Transformations Platform. Broadly looking at technology, policy, business models for which can potentially lead to non-linear or transformational changes in our energy systems. So there are various such platforms in abroad and even in India. Why did we come up with this thing? What was the thought process? The logic was the following. We all thought that India is at a very important stage in its developmental trajectory. The nationally determined contributions, the NDCs, which we announced in Paris COP, were a firm commitment of that India is committed to a low carbon developmental pathway in terms of reducing its carbon intensity to GDP, as well as augmenting fossil free generation and the carbon sink. This was a strong affirmation that the country has taken deep roots in a low carbon developmental pathway. And this is not a new phenomenon, it goes back almost 10 years now, starting with the Copenhagen COP, where first time India announced a commitment, a voluntary commitment of cut in carbon intensity to GDP. In fact, Planning Commission, I recall, in 2009 and 2010, there used to be a committee which was exploring low carbon inclusive growth options. So there have been a progressive series of steps to deepen India's roots in these areas. And I can say with great satisfaction that the policies in energy efficiency, renewables, have taken deep roots and are sort of bearing fruit now. At the same time, we also know that we are well on track to achieve the NDCs. This has been officially acknowledged as well. The minister has also mentioned that India will certainly achieve the NDCs most likely before 2030 itself. So then the question becomes, well, with India now in this kind of a position, at the same time faced with huge developmental paradigms, you know, still millions to lift out of poverty and those developmental challenges facing, what is the next steps? If you take a longer term perspective, can we think of a developmental paradigm which sort of is beyond what other countries have followed? If you look at, say, European countries or the Western countries, there was a period of intense dependence on fossil fuels where emissions peaked, there was a very sharp peak, and now they are trying to decarbonize by various options. As recently China also followed a similar trajectory where emissions reached a very sharp peak, and now there are policies to try and decarbonize by various set of options. India is in a different position, if I may submit so, because historically our emissions never reached that sharp peak. Our carbon intensity to GDP, because of the structure of our economy, that number has always been relatively low and never reached a very fossil intensive high number. And we are further trying to reduce that by the NDC commitments. So the question that we began exploring is, can India carve out an alternate developmental paradigm where we don't compromise on our developmental aspirations at all, but do so on a much lesser carbon intensive manner? And that requires some thinking beyond the ordinary, exploring options which may not be on the table today, exploring options which may be emerging now but may be relevant 10-20 years down the line, non-linear options, and those options could be technology, policy, business models. And that's how this thought process came about. So once this thought process was clear, then we jointly with SDC and Shakti, we put together a team, a group of mentors. We had a core committee, many of them are in the audience right now, who provided great advice to this forum, how to go about it, to navigate the thoughts and identify areas to work into. We identified some sectors which were obviously hard to sort of abate, like the industry or space cooling or the industrial process heating, etc. And we identified four institutions to work on specific studies to explore those areas and come up with some novel solutions. And we provoked them, we encouraged them to think of solutions which are beyond the horizon. So ideas which may sound bizarre today, ideas which may sound foolish today, but which may have the potential of bearing fruit, say, 5, 10, 15 years down the line. So that was how we thought about this particular forum, this platform. Now, in today's meeting, the four institutions will be making their presentations. During the presentation, they have been interacting with the various mentors in this team. They have also met with the relevant policy stakeholders to make sure what they are doing is aligned and is relevant and get good feedback. So they will be presenting today, and we will be looking forward to a very interactive discussion in today's session. So with that, I'll stop with my opening comments, and I will request Marilor to please give her comment, remarks. I request Dr. Ashok Kumar from BE has joined us, if you could please join us here.
A very good morning to all, dear guests and dear participants. I would like to welcome you at the launch of the India Energy Transformation Platform. So I was asking the team this morning, why do we call it the launch? Because we've been meeting so often. Actually, that's the first time the platform is going public, if we can say like this. So in that sense, we want to open and broaden a bit the spectrum of the participation. But actually, what you will hear today, it's a result of a 1.5-year process that started actually in a discussion with the Shakti Foundation at that time, and we were thinking of how to complement the work this is doing in India on low carbon cement, on energy efficiency in building, in renewable, in different sectors, with a more policy approach. So that was a bit the idea, to work in the clean energy policy sphere, and we were not very sure how to go about it. So we had also interesting exchanges at that time with our Swiss Federal Office of Energy, and we wanted to understand how energy policy in Switzerland was being elaborated. And actually, which is quite specific of our Swiss system, it's the participatory approach and the multi-stakeholder way of doing the things. So from this idea, actually, together then with the Indian partner, we came with this proposal to bring together experts and organization from different background, but with a very good record and a lot of network, I would say, in their own field, and to bring them together and try to think a bit differently. So I have to say, I'm not an energy expert, and it was always a bit difficult for me sometimes to follow the discussion of these non-linear and transformative ideas, but you are the expert, and you will have the opportunity to hear about it in a few minutes. So I think we were very happy to engage in something a bit different from what we do normally, and we're also very glad to see the concrete results today. I think if we look forward, we have some challenges ahead of us. From our perspective, actually, we kind of end now our financial support, but definitely we would like to keep engaged and further contribute to this discussion with our expert within the team, but also with our project partners. I think when you bring together a platform, there is always a risk of the sustainability of this type of exercise. So we are very encouraging everyone in the platform, I mean the Shakti CSTEP, but also the different organizations who are there, to keep this momentum and this dynamic, and we will be happy to participate into it in the future. I think we have a good opportunity with the engagement with the industry. So most of the experts and the institutions that are already in the platform are very well, have good networks, and actually there is really an opportunity to bring a lot of this discussion and the results of the study to the industry as such, and to see how we can go from a study to some implementation action. And related to the industry and the private sector approach, I think the policy is definitely needed and required. If you want to upscale this idea and this solution, we need to have also policies and programs. So I'm very happy to see a representative of the ministries this morning here. And I hope that some of these ideas can be then brought further in some of the existing or new programs. For SDC, the work we do in India is also related with some global initiative that we do. One of our partners at the global level is the IEA, the International Energy Agency. And we're, for instance, supporting a program called E4, Energy Efficiency in Emerging Economies. And our experts in Switzerland have been quite involved in the IEA Energy Review for India that was concluded very recently. And I think one of the recommendations of the review was for India to have an energy strategy and an energy policy with a medium to long-term vision, and to do it in a cross-sectorial manner, thinking of having different ministries on board and I think different type of stakeholder. So I hope that this kind of initiative and this kind of platform can also contribute to this broader exercise. So from our side, a big thank you for all the participants of the platform that have been coming very regularly, to the team of Shakti and CSTEP who have been organizing, to the team who's organized this meeting today. It was a lot of work, but I think we have a very good attendance. The mentors that came into the discussion also, and the organization who did the studies as such. So looking forward for this today fruitful exchange. Thank you.
Good morning. I welcome all the participants to the deliberation today. And as Anshu has outlined about the platform, I will refrain from speaking about the platform. But what I want to spell out here is that this platform had a little more than a year-long journey. And this journey would not have been possible without the support of the Swiss Agency for Development Cooperation. So they had faith in an idea which was just proposed to them, and decided to make an early investment in the platform idea. So my sincere thanks and gratitude to the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation for having faith in this idea. I take the opportunity to extend a special welcome to our guests from the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Dr. Watt and Dr. Raghava. I take the opportunity to welcome Dr. Ashok Kumar from Bureau of Energy Efficiency and Seema Arora from the Confederation of Indian Industries. Thank you for making the time to be with us today. In the last 1 year, what the platform has been able to do, Anshu talked in detail about this, but in my own assessment, what we have been able to create is create an infrastructure. And if I may express it in a lighter note, this infrastructure is rather high energy and low carbon. I say high energy because we have a set of mentors who have incredible intellectual capabilities that they guided the conversation of this platform over the last 1 year, and we truly benefited from those conversations, their guidance, their input. So I take the opportunity to thank them, but more importantly, I wanted to recognize that although high energy, not always high energy is high carbon. So thank you for the support and guidance to the platform. Anshu also laid out, and Marilor also articulated that India, in a country like India, our economy has multiple priorities, and that really makes it complex. We are a developing economy. We have development aspirations. We have, like most part of the world, we have major environmental challenges that we need to deal with. And the other challenge is we are operating in a time-constrained environment. Be it our development ambitions, be it our environmental ambitions, I think time is not by our side. Although what is heartening to observe is that the technology is by our side. We have a set of new generation technologies that can help us both address our developmental needs in a fast-tracked fashion, and at the same time take into account how do we balance that with our environmental priorities. Having said that, I fully appreciate and I responsibly state that it will be an oversimplification if I say that because technology is there, we can get there. Technology is there, but technology is only one dimension comprehensive solution that we are looking at. And hence, it is important that we take advantage of what we have and try and figure out what we need to resolve going forward. What we need to resolve going forward are issues of cost, issues of policies, issues of business models, issues of implementation, enforcement, so on and so forth. And hence, what becomes important is when we have challenges of multidimensional nature, it is always beneficial to engage multiple stakeholders, because our life view of or the life view of one individual group could be limited. But when we tap into the outlook, the experience of multiple types of actors, multiple different types of organizations. That's where we can thrive. The diversity of thoughts, diversity of ideas. But if that can be harmonized, and then we can leverage collaborative process to achieve what we want to achieve. We are mindful of that, and hence we are excited. As much we are excited about the first year journey for this platform, we also understand and appreciate that this journey has to continue. So what we are in the process right now is, of course, the Shakti Foundation is deeply interested in moving forward with this platform. We have done some reflection on what have we achieved well. We have done some reflection, more importantly, on what has not worked well. Because it would be dishonest for me to say that this journey was all wonderful. We have had some areas where we need to improve going forward. Those discussions, at a team level, we are beginning to have that conversation. We are beginning to engage with our partners, CSTEP, on that conversation, and we will reflect on that. We will look at how can we consolidate whatever is working well, and how can we address areas that are not working well, and then we will put in, we hope to put in an even stronger process going forward. I would, before I conclude, I would request the continued support from the mentors that have guided this platform process so well. And once we put together our thoughts, we will also have some discussions with our mentors, with the platform mentors, and then we will put together a concrete plan on what is the future year journey going to look like. My sincere thanks to our partner organization, CSTEP, for all their hard work. Anshu has been a very dear colleague for many years, but there are members of the staff members in CSTEP. I'm not going to recognize each of them individually, but they have done a great job in contributing to this success of this platform. Last but not the least, my colleagues. I would like to recognize Disha Agarwal, who has been very instrumental from the Shakti side in guiding this process. But she has been ably contributed by many other colleagues at Shakti. So thank you, Disha, and thank you all for all your hard work. Thank you so much. And I hope that we have very productive deliberations today, and that helps us move forward with the objective of IETP. The name sums it all: India Energy Transformation Platform. And if there is any ambiguity, please refer to the logo. And as you will see, we are the arrow to the green is a wonderful journey, and I hope that you will agree with me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mary Lord. Thank you, Chin Mayor, for the comments. May I request Seema Ji to please share her perspectives now.
Good morning, distinguished dignitaries on the dais, friends, ladies and gentlemen. First, let me congratulate all of you at the launch of this very interesting and very critical initiative, the India Energy Transformation Platform. I think the name itself is very, very, I would say important, because it conveys the need and the crucial need that we have now to move towards a transformation in way of what we have been doing till now. So I think it's very aptly named in terms of the objective that it intends to serve. I'm happy to be able to participate and join you today for this launch, and to hear Chinmaya and also Anshu and others to talk about what the objective is. I think industry, as was mentioned, is a key stakeholder in any of these transformations. And you may all be aware, but industry has been playing a little role in also making sure that the existential crisis that we all face in terms of the climate change issues that we are seeing every day and which are very close to us now and not so far as they used to look like earlier, it has also impacted businesses in many ways. It impacts all of us as well. So industry has been playing its role, be it in response to the policy initiatives that the government brings in, and BE is here. They have been spearheading the energy efficiency journey, which I would think the industry has ably responded with. But I think the vision around bringing, you know, various types of initiatives from a policy point of view really triggered the imagination and got the action of industry going in energy efficiency. And CII and its members have also therefore been able to contribute ably, and definitely many sectors have contributed, but we all know that the cement sector in India has achieved global benchmarks and has already also put out a roadmap ahead how they will continue to increase, improve their energy efficiency. So I think if there is the right kind of policy direction, industry does have the ability, has the the technological and other resources to be able to lead a transformation that we are actually looking for. Similar has been the case in the renewable energy, though I would think that we still have a few challenges. And we all familiar with those challenges, and therefore a transformative approach to the renewable energy sector is definitely required now. The feed-in subsidies, the generation-based subsidies have taken us to a level where we can say that we are proud that we have large, you know, solar and wind capacity. But if we really need to scale, then there are multiple things that need to be put into place. And again, I think a platform like this can come out with out-of-the-box suggestions of how journey can be scaled up even further. And we know that, you know, there are challenges that the renewable energy sector is facing. It needs a lot of coordinated execution in terms of, you know, making sure right from the land acquisition to the transmission to the financing and the offtake risk all are actually, you know, taken care of. And also, I think the focus from, we always think, you know, we think big, because scale we think is big, and that's natural, whether it's government or industry. Scale is something that all of us get very, you know, motivated by. But I think in the case of certain solutions, we also need to look at that small is beautiful, and therefore we need to look at, you know, decentralized type of solutions which might work in a country like India, which has so much diversity, and we know one size doesn't fit all. So I think here again, a transformative platform like this can come out with those recommendations, can certainly, you know, push the envelope to see what more can be done to really meet the potential that we have in this country. I would think that, you know, in the case of industry and the building sector, we have seen a huge amount of transformation. The entire story of green buildings was led by the private sector, again ably supported by certain policy measures, but I think voluntarily itself, the industry has been able to, you know, showcase that it makes business sense to build new stock of buildings which are much more greener and are much more energy efficient. And I think that has proven to be a good story for India in terms of the transformation. Much more, of course, can be done, but I think we definitely have a roadmap that we can follow here. We have seen lately, and you would have followed, that industry has also signed up to various global initiatives, whether it's the science-based targets or it's the, you know, the RE100 or the EP100. We have seen a lot of desire from industry to be able to contribute their bit. I think again here we can push the industry even more if we can show that even policy direction would welcome this kind of change in behavior. And I think here we have BE and we have Dr. Bhatt, who play an amazing role in making sure that there is a directional clarity in terms of the long-term policy, so that investments from industry actually go into a low carbon future rather than being locked into a high carbon future. And that would really be very, very helpful as well. It is already happening and more can be done. And I'm not going to talk about the work that the government has already led in terms of the NDCs and so many things that we already see coming out, right from the National Action Plan on Climate Change to what we have seen. But more of this and more sectoral, you know, such clarity, directional policy clarity will really help industry make sure that their future investments are actually low carbon. Industry does want to make sure that they do not have climate risk. They want to future-proof their investments. They are understanding this is an issue. Now, I cannot generalize and say that all industry understand it. I'm primarily talking of the large sector. You know, large sector which is globally connected, which has seen, you know, that water and which has the exposure to all the different dialogues that keep happening. Their boards are discussing this issue of climate change. And I can tell you, they call us and they call CII to talk about what can be done and how we can make sure our future investments, not only future, even our current investments are climate proof because of the issues of, you know, the different weather patterns and the freaky weather patterns that we see. You can see a lot of, and you know, rebuilding any infrastructure, as you know, takes a huge amount of you know, resources, both time, money, and you know, the displacement cost is so high. So the industry does want to do that, and I think that's a very positive signal. And now, if we can put a framework by which we can put all the actors together, and maybe that's what we are trying to do here, where you have the solution, you have, you know, the policy direction, and you have the, you know, the ability to also showcase what business models can work in that, it would be very helpful. The MSME sector is a little different, as we all know, and that I think really needs the transformative thinking. And I would really request that the India Energy Transformation Platform looks at the MSME sector very closely, because a lot of the chunk of the carbon is locked into the MSME sector. So the supply chain, the value chain of the large companies, for example, the large companies do tier one GHG, you know, mapping. They've started to do tier two. Tier three is still very less. And that's where the MSME lies. And I think if we can look at how the energy transformation platform can come up with non-linear solutions and, you know, ideas for how the MSME sector, and we definitely have to do this sectorally, obviously, but how we can really decarbonize the MSME sector. And here again, you know, as CII, we have been doing our bit. We can, of course, do much more with the help of many other stakeholders. But we did start a program called the Climate Action Program 2.0. It's CAP 2.0, which really means cap all emissions at 2.0. I know even that is not enough, but that was at least the beginning. And there we are basically trying to push the envelope of action by industry. So while there are a lot of these commitments, we are also going and checking if the commitments lead to action. And the action is not just in tier scope 1, scope 2, but also scope 3. It's very tough, and that's where we are taking a journey of building the capacity of the MSME sector, which feeds into the large companies to see if they can be, you know, made to understand. They understand energy efficiency, not to say, so BE has done a tremendous job of communicating the, you know, the importance of energy efficiency. But here we are talking of beyond energy efficiency, and where you're actually looking at technological solutions which help you decarbonize, and that's requires money, that requires, you know, different type of mindset. So there are challenges there. I just want to leave one thought before I end for the transformative platform to look at. And I think I'm very happy Anshu talked of non-linear, you know, ideas, because that's where we need to go. It's all about the interconnectedness of the issues. So climate is not just an issue, or an issue which is a separate issue. Climate is linked to nature, to biodiversity, to air pollution, to resource efficiency. So we have to really look at the interconnectedness of all these issues. Unless we look at from the interconnectedness lens, we're never going to get transformation. Yeah? And that's where we have to really head. So three things we have to do. We have to really be science-based, because science is what's going to tell us what's really happening. We obviously have to look at our sustainability lens, and that's long term. So we're not developing solutions for today. We are actually developing solutions for the long term. So science, sustainability, and we have to always look for systemic solutions. So science, systems and sustainability is what is the three things that we always have to look at. And I'm sure that the India Energy Transformative Platform is also looking at it. In this 2020, which is really the super year as we know, yeah, we have so many things that are happening in year 2020. We have the SDGs completing 5 years. We have the Aichi biodiversity targets, which are going to be renegotiated. We have the Paris Agreement completing 5 years, et cetera, et cetera. So this is really our super year. We need to really push ourselves. We need to push the envelope. But one very important thing that we have to also remember is that while we develop all these solutions, we have to also look at the inclusivity part of it. We are not we will not be successful as a global community or as even a national community, and more so in a country like India, if we are not able to provide solutions which are sustainable and inclusive, not just for the large companies and all of us sitting in this room, but also for the people whose voice is not represented even here. People at the base of the pyramid. And we really have to also, through this energy transformation platform, look at solutions right for the base of the pyramid as well. And unless we create that transformation, we're not going to transform as a society. Again, we'll have the have-nots and the haves, even in the energy transition. So the last thing we want to do in this energy transition is to have the people who have access and who have all the wherewithal to have the transformative solutions, but we also create the divide between the ones who do not have. So I think we have to be very, very careful and mindful that as we develop solutions, we must look at people, the MSME sector, who again are the have-nots in a way, in our industrial, you know, hierarchy, but also in our society, look at the people who are also at the base of the pyramid and who need this transformation because they are as vulnerable, even more vulnerable. They pay for these services even more than you and I pay for. So we must look at that lens as well. And that's the sweet spot that we have to hit if we really want the transformation to happen. And I want to end by giving one example as how we are trying to do this. We basically, as CII, for the last 4 years, have looked at this issue of air pollution very closely. We started, of course, looking at NCR air pollution because all of us talk about NCR air pollution. And one of the issues that was highlighted was this issue of the crop residue burning. And everybody, of course, tends to blame the farmers, which is not my intention. But I want to talk about our experiences in working in 100 villages in 6 districts with farmers in Punjab and Haryana. And there's a lot of learning from that, which I want to really share with all of you. And the learning is one. Again, if you want to solve a problem, look at it from the lens of the person who's facing the problem. So if we are trying to solve the problem of air pollution, and saying that we will solve the problem of the farmer from an air pollution lens, we'll never solve it. We have to actually look at the problem from the farmer's point of view and say, what is his problem? His problem is he needs something for 15 days, a solution for cost-effective solution, which he can have access to for 15 days when he does his cropping cycle. So we started to look at it from a farmer point of view, and we found multiple solutions. In fact, in the 100 villages that we worked in about 100,000 acres of farmland, we were able to get 85% of farmers not to burn. And that was done because we were able to give them a solution which was cost effective, which they would have access to. And we also backed it up by actually giving them real-time advisory of how to use that solution. One of the things that we do in solutions, and because this is about transformative solutions, we create the solution, but we forget that the user of the solution may need a lot of capacity building and a lot of change. So what we did was also give real-time advisory services to these farmers to how to use that solution. And that's where we made the ecosystem change to work for the farmers and solve the problem. Of course, we have miles to go because we've only done 100 villages, and as a country, we have to do many more. But a key thing is we talk about technology, we talk about cost, we talk about policy, we talk about business models. We also need to talk about behavior change and capacity building. And no solution is complete until we look at all of these. And therefore, I want to leave this thought that let's come up with transformative solutions that look at the science system sustainability, that push the envelope to go beyond the traditional sectors that we look at. We must look at the traditional sectors, but there's a huge amount to do with the MSME and at the base of the pyramid. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Seemaji. Thank you so much for sharing a very rich set of perspectives. I really liked your focus on the scale part. You're absolutely right. Whatever comes out has to be scalable, and industry likes scale. your focus on MSME is spot on. That's one sector which has been very hard to work with, but it's incredibly important from various points of view. And your point about the three S's, the science, systems, and sustainability, and capacity building, I mean, you couldn't have said it better. So thank you so much for your perspectives. I request Dr. Ashok Kumar, Director of Bureau of Energy Efficiency, to please share his perspectives. Ashok ji is again known to all of us. He has been very passionately working in the space of energy efficiency policy and regulation, helping shape India's energy efficiency policies, which is a key pillar in our direction to a low carbon growth pathway. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhardwaj, dignitaries on the dais, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I thank CSTEP for the invitation and the partner agency Shakti and the SDC for coming up with this platform. For me, my apology for being late, and actually my DG was supposed to attend this, but because of some personal engagement, he couldn't join. So you have to have this, it's the second version of the B, so you would have better, you know, if he could have joined here. So having said that, I think I would take from what, when I was entering the room, Dr. Bhardwaj was mentioning about a developmental path which might be different than what has been so far. So that is a place where I just want to begin, that India at this point in time is placed at a very different, you can say, in the history, at a very different situation, very different timelines, very different environment, very different, you know, the placing a context altogether. And if we are looking at a developmental path and looking in the all aspects of, Madam Seema has told about the, sustaining, taking the science and a systemic solution, possibly that solution will be way different than what it has been. So India has to find out its own way out. There would not be any history or any guidelines or any template for India to look for. So that is my personal take, that, you know, we and here people who are less energy intensive experts are here. So for them, this is the challenge, that we, how we steer our growth story through such constrained, narrow lanes of resource constraint, carbon constraint, several other constraints of population constraint, and so on and so forth. So that is our challenge. And being, 1/6 of the world population, we have a great, great things to do. And of course, we also recognize that we have the resources. You know, we have brilliant people here with the expertise. And as Dr. Acharya also mentioned, we have a technology at hand. So how these possible enabling ecosystem can be made favorable for a country like India, so that we can have a lifestyle or a living standard of our own making, not comparable, not comparison to New York or maybe Canada or Vancouver, maybe our own making, on our own benchmark, our own style. So that is, I think, we need. And for me, I have very little to offer to the what the platform is going to be. I would be looking very sincerely to this platform so that we can have the benefit of that platform. And I would visualize that that platform would be a single window place for an operating entity like B to go to. For example, if we want some analysis to be looked at, we would approach the platform that, you know, we are looking for certain sectors that we want to be put under PAT, just for example. So we would go to the platform and we would request that, you know, how is that sector is looking at, what are its saving potential, what are the technology available, how we can put those particular areas. For example, Madam Seema has mentioned about MSMEs. If you want to get into MSME, what are the details, what how need to be benchmarked, how we can incentivize, how we can be regulated, and so on and so forth. So that level of the platform, we are hoping that this would have the capacity to do the analysis of the ground reality of our times, particularly at the challenge that we have. MSMEs are very disorganized, doesn't have much of a capacity to understand the nuances of development, efficiency, technology. So within that, how this platform can help such industries, then going beyond industry, maybe at the household level or any other places where, you know, we can, this platform can provide some kind of guidance tool or a place where, you know, all single solution. Because again, when we look at, you know, particularly, for example, you know, in a simplistic way, that when we reach to sector like cement, now the cement has reached to a stage where, you know, it has touched the global benchmark. So then that now that non-linearity or disruptive activities or the technologies that are needed for a sector right here. So those are the urgency, and also the urgency of the timelines that we have set. There is a timeline of 2030 that is very, very, very well recognized. But then 2030 is not the end of the world. You know, we have to go beyond 2030 also. So it's wonderful that the platform is looking at a longer version of, you know, the timeline. So we as a country certainly needs all that medium term, short term, long term, and technology, finance, and all aspects of that, so that we can have a strategy or a platform which can cater to the diversity of the size and scale that we have. And also, I would not take much time just to say that, you know, one scholar has said that often, you know, we particularly the community of science and technology often tries to look the problem also from their own perspective. You know, we think that climate, or as I think Madam Seema has also taken to that direction, that this also has to do with society, behavior, sociology, anthropology, many other aspects of the, because it is a societal. So many say that this climate issue is not a technical issue, but it is a social issue. It is a further, wider issue where we also need to have that social angle to the solution. So possibly, you know, that the kind of limits to use, efficiency versus sufficiency, and several other concepts that are emerging now. So how those can be inculcated? So we have to devise that, you know, we do not have any prescription to how to do it, but we have to devise some way or that. This platform, why I'm just thinking loud, is that I perceive that this is a place where, you know, you can throw wildest ideas, as Dr. Anshu was mentioning in the beginning, that it might think very absurd at this point in time, but down the line, maybe that can provide us the way out in this complex world. So that is the kind of broader, I think we have prolific speaker, Dr. Butt is going to come after me, so I will not waste your time. So thank you very much again for my invitation, and congratulations for the platform. And we would be certainly looking very eagerly for the progress and your contribution, particularly in the energy efficiency space where we work. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Ashok. Thank you so much. Yeah, I completely agree that on the issue of developmental pathway, it is indeed an opportunity for India to carve out a unique pathway, which, if we successfully demonstrate, could be a model for other developing countries as well. So that's exactly the unique sweet spot that we are trying to explore. Your suggestion on this platform being like a repository of knowledge and information actually is a great suggestion. I think we should discuss that internally among ourselves. If we position this platform as a place which has where institutions like BE can reach out to for quick analyses, quick studies on issues of interest to you, that something is a great idea, and I think we'll definitely give thought to it among internally. And I request Dr. J.R. Bhatt, the final speaker of this session, to please share his perspectives. Again, Bhatt Sahib is known to all of us for his leadership and his inspiration in climate policy issues. And I'll request him to please share his views.
Thank you. My colleagues on the dais and those in the audience, brothers and sisters. Very good morning to all of you. Said very good morning to all of you. I, at the outset, let me greet you on my own behalf and on behalf of Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. The very fact that you have been braving the cold and you are all here is a testimony of your commitment and passion to the subject. Unless you were interested in the subject, you would not have been here. So, welcome to this platform. And at the outset, also grateful thanks to Shakti Foundation and CSTEP, and also our partner from the Swiss Development Cooperation. India enjoys excellent relationship with Swiss people, so thanks to SDC for, and to Madam Mary Lord for partnering this with these two Indian counterparts for this very important subject. My task has been made so easy by the previous speakers, and I am not going to bore you with any typical numbers or any data, but I want to leave some thoughts with you. And let me pick up the thread from where my colleagues have left, starting, of course, with a very passionate talk by Dr. Seema. So, she spoke of the interconnectedness of things. And I'll take just 1 minute to further elaborate on that. You see, the challenges that come to a country like a vast developing country like India, they come as a delegation. They don't knock at our door individually. They come as a delegation. Sometimes we are told that, you know, biodiversity loss is happening, so you need to rise and help the world. Sometimes we are told that ozone is depleting, there would be a hole, and so rise to the challenge of ozone, then to the persistent organic pollutants, transboundary hazardous waste, mercury and whatnot, and to all, and also the overarching challenge and framework of a changing climatic regime. So we are roped into things where our contribution has been minimal, but as a spirit of partnership, of brotherhood with the global community, India has always risen and said that yes, we will be with you, and we will also partner to solve all these global problems which are not our making, but which the world is facing because of over-excessive consumption patterns of our brothers and sisters from the developed world. Look what a mess we are in, be it climate change, be it biodiversity loss, be it ozone, be it anything. And once the world is in this kind of a jeopardy, now every nation is asked that, all right, don't do what we did. And we are also conscious that we live in a very unequal world. Unequal world, some joined the development bus early. Some could do that at a later date. But certainly we do not want to endanger the planet. And we do not wish as a country to develop in any dirty manner. We want to develop in a neat, clean, green manner. And when I say this, it is from a position of strength that I speak on behalf of government, on behalf of the country, because there is a report card that we can be proud of. In the past 5 years, you see, from 2014 to 19, our renewable has increased by almost 12 times. We don't want to follow a path which is not clean. We are conscious, and we have consciously taken this path where, apart from our NDCs, we had announced that we will have 175 gigawatt of renewable, which was further, increased to 450 by our dear and respected Prime Minister. And then the report card, there is another element to it. And that element of interconnectedness I wish to bring in here. Because all this is in the backdrop of increase in forest and tree cover. At a time when forests and mangroves, such assets, are on decline worldwide, India is registering an increase. And forests are also teeming with wildlife. You have 70% of tigers in the wild supported by these forests on just 2.4% of land area, as was said by one of the speakers previously. We hold on to our forests with little or no financial assistance from the world, and they are teeming with tigers, with lions, with rhinos, with elephants. We do have problems of man-animal conflict. We have difficulties. But then overall report card is something that we can be proud of as Indians. And we have stopped beating drums about our own achievements, because the world says independent agencies have rated India very highly in the climate debate and 2-degree compliant. And let me say with assertion that while we embark on a neat, green, clean path, and that we are not a coal mafia, we have only 6% of those resources in a yardstick of 100, and that will remain our mainstay, because that is how it is for the rest of the world. You can't have a transition overnight. It will be our mainstay. And there is an explicit acknowledgement in the convention that the emissions of developing countries will grow to meet their social and developmental needs. Because these are survival emissions, these are not luxury emissions of the Western Europe and Northern America. These are, or the centrally industrializing states. These are the survival emissions. But then the question is, are we and will we burn the coal responsibly? It is for the world to see, because we are moving towards ultra-supercritical. We are burning. World wanted us to burn our coal responsibly, we are doing that. We have also retired the old and inefficient units. I have Dr. Ajay, director in the ministry, who handles climate change. Ajay, how many units we have closed down? 170 units we have closed, which is a testimony that we are serious. And we are serious as a government, as people in this country. And at a time when the world was talking about inconvenient truth, the PM who was CM at that time, he was imagining about convenient solutions. So, commitment is at the top, commitment is with the government, commitment is of people who are having climate-friendly lifestyles. That is our first NDC. And based on what India said to the world, that is also a part and parcel of Paris Agreement. Climate-friendly lifestyles, to which this country is committed. Chinmay said very nicely about cost policy, business model, implementation, enforcement. Yes, these are the steps that any country would follow, and we included as a vast developing country. But he also said about the platform and drew the attention to the arrow which from brown to yellow, it is moving towards green. And I think that is the right way to think about it, because I would only disagree with one small thing, and that is, it is not just brown to green, it is green to greener. Why? Because today we are worried about our emissions. The whole world is worried. Whole world is worried what is India going to do in terms of its emissions. But what are our emissions? Where do we stand in the yardstick of 100? So our annual emissions are just 2 billion tons. Around. And what the world is worried about, when this will become 14 billion tons of China, or when it will become 12 billion tons of US, or when it will become 8 to 9 billion tons of EU. I'm saying these figures roughly. So, world also feels that, you know, you are too many people in just 2.4% of land area, 1.3 billion and going stronger. Yes, it's an assertion. When I say yes, it is an assertion that I am making. But this is our strength. And if you see from per capita, or per capita is one third, but they would say, the world would disagree with you and say, well, your per capita are very low because you are too much of protoplasm on this much of land on earth. So be careful. Don't develop in a wrong way. Agreed. But see our report card in terms of cumulative emissions, because CO2 lives in atmosphere for more than 250 to 300 years. That's what the Westerners are teaching us through IPCC reports. So all those molecules which have accumulated up in the atmosphere, which are causing problem, precipitating the problem today, they are since Industrial Revolution. And if you count from 1850 to 2010, the cumulative energy emissions from India against a yardstick of 100, they are just 2.74%. We are not saying this. The world databases are saying. So, please don't worry about India when this 2.74% cumulative or one third of world average per capita or 2 billion ton annually will become 14 of China or that of US or that of EU. No, we are very responsible. We are developing in a most responsible manner where we have increased the share of renewables. We have committed to the world that the total non-fossil fuel capacity would be 40%. So that capacity we are dot on time. And we are doing much more than that, which we are showcasing through various documents that we give to the world periodically. And as Madam Mary Lord said, there was an in-depth review by the IEA, and IEA team has also reached a similar conclusion that yes, we are 2-degree compliant, we are doing our best, and we have embarked on a path which is greener, cleaner, and neater, and we are not endangering the world in any manner. We have very strong MRV system also. Take for example the PAT scheme. My colleague Ashok, he spoke, and that is a kind of a report card for the whole world to see how we are doing MRV of our more than 500 designated consumers. And I agree to buy those three S's: science base, sustainability, and systemic solutions. Yes, all those three are somehow into that thread of connectivity, though we have never spoken them in the manner that she spoke today morning in terms of industry, where we are second to none. A small point was also made by her on farmers. Who made that point? I think you made that point. And I must say that, you know, for the farmer, because in India you don't have monopolies in farming. You don't have industrial agriculture. Farming is done by small landholders who brave the vagaries of weather, who toil very hard, till the land, dependent on rains and vagaries of weather. And these small farmers, they collectively produce for the nation food. So they should not be now told by our colleagues from the developed world that, look, you have to also, your farming systems have to act as a dustbin for over excessive CO2 that we are emitting. And we continue to do so because we don't want to change our lifestyles. So this burden is also on you to now mitigate. No. Their first and foremost priority is and would remain, and that is adaptation. They have adaptation needs. Because some countries are reluctant to mitigate, the adaptation needs are rising. And this the world must understand. In any debate on energy, world must understand our situation, we don't have industrial agriculture. We have small land holdings which further get divided through inheritance. So we are doing our best to be self-sufficient and not turn to anybody for our food requirements. So that needs to be respected. And at the end, let me say this, and say this very confidently, that we are on track, we are doing our bit, but there are limits. And limit is, you can't squeeze the stone and start taking water out of it. So the world community needs to understand the way we are organized on 2.4% of land area with so many challenges. And as Dr. Anshu said, that we have to lift millions out of poverty. And yet, see our report card. Judge us from what we are doing as a nation and what is our ambition to develop and the way we have chosen a path to develop, which will, I am sure, at the end of your study, you would come to a conclusion. I am not prejudging it, but I am sure you will come to, after all your research and study, you will come to a conclusion that yes, as a responsible nation, we are doing our bit and we will continue to do so and embark on a path which the world can use as a role model for the others, because my colleague Ashok said there are no templates or guidelines. Yes, let us create one. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you so much, Bhatt Saab. Thank you for your very rich perspectives from your experience. Yes, the points were spot on. The point on report card is absolutely spot on. What India has announced as its climate policy initiatives, the NDCs, or before that the voluntary commitments, should be seen in the context of where we are coming from, of having played no role in creating the problem of climate change. And the 2 gigaton number of our present emissions is minuscule as compared to what the global present number or the historical number of cumulative emissions which have been emitted. In fact, we also did a little analytical exercise that if we plot India's carbon emissions in the last, say, 6 to 7 years, and if we plot GDP trends in the last 6 to 7 years, there is a clear de-linking. So we can say with confidence that despite the fact of our huge developmental challenges, despite the fact that we have a massive problem of lifting millions out of poverty, we are already on a path where we have sort of somewhat de-linked GDP from carbon emissions, which to me is a great accomplishment, and which itself is a new path on the way to sort of de-link carbon from GDP. In that sense, it's already a new template, as Ashok Ji was talking about. And what we are trying to see is, can we take it further and explore new pathways without compromising on growth. Your point on coal was also spot on, that today India's coal capacity of about 200 gigawatts should be seen in the context of the fact that China already is sitting on some 1,000 gigawatts of coal. And there was a time when China was sort of inaugurating one coal power plant every week in late 80s and 90s. We are not doing that. And today our 200 gigawatts, if you look at plants in the pipeline, might increase to some number, but even those are state-of-the-art, most efficient coal power plants. So thank you so much for sharing your perspectives. Friends, with that, we'll have come to an end of this session of the workshop. I thank all our respected speakers and members on the dais. I thank all of you for being excellent audience and listeners. Thank you again, as Bhartav said, for braving the cold and coming for this today's meeting. As we move on to the next session, I also want to thank colleagues from Shakti and CSTEP who have been who have played a very important role in this entire exercise over last more than a year. A special word of thanks for Shakti colleagues Disha, Aishwarya, and my CSTEP colleagues Purnima and Ilika, who have been the backbone of this particular initiative. They have worked very hard in all the meetings to get all the meetings organized, talk to the teams, work with the mentors, generate new ideas. Their support has been outstanding, and a special word of thanks for all of them. On a personal note, I just want to acknowledge a contribution of Deepak Gupta, who a dear friend who used to be with Shakti and now is with the Renew Power, who during his Shakti days was very passionate about this platform. And he, along with Chinmaya and I, we came up this idea. So I, even though he's not a Shakti, he's now with Renew Power in the industry. But as you can see, he joined the renewable industry and not anywhere else. So I just wanted to acknowledge his contribution. And also I would like to thank my CSTEP's team, communication and admin team, for their excellent effort in organizing today's workshop, of Merlin, Lydia, Lalita, and Mayank for their support. So friends, we come to a close of this. We'll take a 10-minute break as we regroup for the next session. Then we'll have the presentations for the of the four groups. From the audience, my sincere request to all of you is to give honest feedback. The four studies that we have done, so the groups have done so far, what they have come up with would benefit from your feedback. So please think about, are these the right areas to work in? Are these good topics? Are they relevant topics? Are the studies in the right direction? Are they likely to bring about solutions which could potentially make non-linear contributions? So please think along those lines and give your honest and opinion. We'll all benefit from that. Thank you very much, all of you, and we look forward to the next sessions.